So the good news is that I get to work at one of the coolest places on Earth, which is DeviantArt, where I'm the advisor in chief. We do all kinds of things like this, you know. This is what we do. I also have to confess to you that I'm also a professor, and because I'm a professor, I might get a little dry at times. So feel free to go to sleep. Many of my students do. The other little piece of bad news is that I'm actually a lawyer, which has the potential of making me really, 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 really boring and dry. And then the worst news for some of you, if you're actually concerned about fan art and the law, is that I'm the former acting general counsel of Paramount Pictures Corporation. And when I was there, my job was to be, in part, the top cop for intellectual property issues. So I've been on both sides of the fence, obviously, and I hope you forgive me for my background and accept me for who I am today. So DeviantArt is a very large community. How many of you are members of DeviantArt? Terrific. So you know that it's big, you know that there's lots of stuff up there, and if you guys are at Comic-Con, you know that we have a great deal of fan art. Which is why it's particularly useful for me to be able to talk about this. Fan activity really appears as a perfect ecosystem. You know, the creators and owners want to have fans. If you get fans, the way to get fans is to have them show their love and admiration for your product, for your work. The more fans you have, the better they are at being fans, and the better your work is. The better your work gets, the more fans you get. And so, there's this sort of symbiosis and this sort of cycle, this sort of ecosystem, like the really boring ones in middle school about rain and stuff. But the owners and authors want to be in control of the work. And most specifically, they want to control the flow of money from the work. That's important to them. And on the other hand, fans are perfect customers. So that works out too. It should be this sort of perfect, happy, happy land. But there's a paradox, particularly with fan art. There are all kinds of ways to express yourself as being a fan. I mean, one of the strongest ways here at Comic-Con that you see, I saw it from my hotel window, which is across the street, thousands of people standing in a line at 7 o'clock in the morning. That's being a fan. That's showing your devotion. There are people who do cosplay. We have quite a few here, which is hi, Batgirl, or Batman as a girl, or girl as Batman. Cosplay is an extraordinary expression of fandom, and the amount of work that goes into building these costumes is just extraordinary, and the dedication and the involvement that you have with the work when you do that is a very, very special kind of relationship. Some people, go into therapy because they're fans. The classic fandom of all fandom is to write a mash note, although I know these days it would be a mash tweet. I don't know what a mash tweet is, except for a dead bird. One of these ways of expressing your love and being a fan is art. And that could be art in any way. It could be writing something, it could be painting something. But when fans participate with original work, which is sort of the art part of it, they're participating in exactly the same way as the original artists participated with the work, sometimes in the exact same medium. And that sort of creates a dissonance. The love can be, this really strong challenge. To the original artists, it can be a challenge to the people who own the property. And in the worst situations, it actually undermines the canon of the work that they are attracted to. love hurts sometimes, right? And if you're Katie Holmes and love hurts, you go find a lawyer. So the law is a really sort of complex thing. And the core of the law that applies to fan art is called intellectual property law, IP law. And IP law is pretty counterintuitive. And I'll explain why in a second. And because it's counterintuitive, it's really useful to get somebody who has this kind of tattoo on their butt, which is the little dark rain cloud, which is one of the people I work with. They came into my office and drew that on my whiteboard and said that this is who I was. People came in, you know, full of bright and sunshine, and I just rained on whatever they were talking about. Isn't that sad? The good part is I got my therapy out of the way before working at DeviantArt. So there are three kinds of law, and the first kind of law is what I call the law of the playground. And the law of the playground is, you know, really the basic rules that people understand about fairness, about right, about wrong. And sometimes those rules are actually much harsher than the civilized rules that parents come up with. But I have never seen in a playground one boy say to another boy, "You can't be Batman because I'm Batman," and survive for very long. I've never seen someone say, "I'm the only person who can sing this song," to another child and survive for very long. And having said that, the whole playground will turn on them, including the parents, who will say, "You know, I'm sorry, Julie, you have to let, you know, John be Batgirl for a while. You can't be running around telling them they can't do that." Okay? So the law of the playground. And then there are the rules of life. Okay? This is what people really are in life. This is how they really behave. And in the context of what we're talking about, this is a classic example of one of the rules. Copyright, trademark, a whole bunch of other stuff, which we'll get into briefly, protects intellectual works, original works of authorship. But it's well understood in the industry, very, very well understood in the industry, in the entertainment industry, the comic industry, the publishing industry, that an artist as part of their portfolio can create this kind of work, whether or not they have permission from the owners of these works, for the purposes of showing it to people as their talent, as their capability, as their skill. That's an understood rule. But as we go through these other things, you will see that, you know, this violates every single possible real law, written law, that we have in this area. But it's okay. It's okay because the world of real world, the real society, adopts that, absorbs that, and says it's okay and we're not going to do anything about it. Because we need to have these excuses for certain types of activities. And then there's this. The black letter law is the real law. That's the law that politicians and others have put together and have decided that this is what we have to do. This is what our parents started doing to us very young, back when we were on the playground and happy and open and free. And these are the sets of IP laws that we have: copyright, trademark, right of publicity, and unfair competition. Whenever you do legal analysis, it's an incredibly complex process. People who are lay people, civilians who are not lawyers, people who still are friendly and kind and haven't turned into dry, mean people, they don't sometimes appreciate that it's not just the law. It's very hard for us to say yes or no to almost anything. Applying the law to the facts of whatever the situation is. And the facts are deeply, deeply important. And when you do that, when you function as a lawyer, your brain looks something like this. You're trying to find all the places where everything connects so that you can somehow, out of this miasma of multicolored connectors, come up with an understanding. It's kind of like this is going on in your brain it's the whole internet. So, copyright law. What is copyright? So copyright covers the expression in any original work of authorship. It includes the graphic elements, the characters, if they're fleshed out, not just sort of the notion of a character, because that would be the idea, but the way a character is fleshed out, the expression of that character, as well as style at times. A very, very distinctive drawing style like Calvin and Hobbes can be subject to copyright. You could draw things that are not Calvin and not Hobbes in the style of Calvin and Hobbes, and you could have yourself a copyright issue. Story, obviously, makes sense, and plot and themes. But there are thin copyrights, which means that you didn't do a lot that's copyrightable, and thick copyrights, which means that everything you did was brand new and original and cool, and so therefore you get a deeper level of protection. Essentially, you should work and operate on the premise that if it wasn't created before 1923, it's still under copyright. And if it's being created today, the bad news is it's going to be, or good news, depending on who you are. If you make money off of copyrights, it's great news. Copyrights last for a very, very long time, the life of the author plus 70 years. And for corporate works, if they're not published for 120 years from creation, if they're published from 95 years from publication, that's a very, 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 very long time. I will not be around, even me. At that point, right? And people talk about the public domain all the time, and people will tell you that something's in the public domain, and I'm not here to give you legal advice. I can't give you legal advice, and what I say is entirely personal views on my part, not the views of DeviantArt or other clients that I may have. Nonetheless, allow me to tell you that if you're interested in something being in the public domain or not, go see a lawyer. If you're really going to rely on it to any financial degree. It is more complicated than it seems, and this link right here, if you can write really quick, is the best outline on the public domain on the internet. So copyright law is a monopoly. It gives the creator a monopoly, and the creator can pass that on to anyone they want, such as Marvel, such as Disney, such as Paramount, such as, you know, anybody. They can pass it on to their family and friends. They can pass it on to others. And you can pass on any little bit of the copyright to anybody you want. The right to do it, you know, the right to draw a picture of my character on Sunday with as long as you're hanging upside down. You can do that. And then when Sunday comes and goes, they no longer have the right to do anything with the character. You can also say you can have the character forever and ever and ever for anything at all, and anything in between. You get these exclusive rights in copyright, and one of them is the right to make a copy, one is to distribute, and one is derivative works. Those are the ones relevant to people who are engaged in fan art. And copying doesn't just mean tracing or duplicating with a photocopying machine. It also means replicating the character. So it means doing a different version of the character, having the character, you know, in different kinds of clothes, in different kinds of settings, doing different kinds of things, can implicate the right to copy under the copyright law. Distribution is by any means, for any reason, in any size, any way, on the internet, not on the internet, in a movie theater, not in a movie theater, you know, on a teeny little piece of paper that you pass to someone in the classroom, that's technically distribution under the copyright law. And a derivative work means making something based upon the copyrighted work or integrating the copyrighted work. And that is an exclusive right of the owner of the copyrighted work. A play, a book, a movie, a drawing, a comic, a sculpture, a costume, any of these things based upon the work implicates the copyright. This cosplay stuff implicates the copyright in a copyrighted character because it's a derivative work based upon the character. And that's the exclusive right of the copyright owner. And it doesn't matter whether you do it for profit or whether you do it for free under the copyright law. Makes absolutely no difference in terms of it being an infringement of copyright. It's a really powerful hammer, copyright law, on purpose to protect authors who otherwise on the playground would have no protection whatsoever. On the playground, anybody could take anything they did. So that's why we have those laws. Copyright law is backed up by some really heavy penalties and damages. You can get an injunction if you're a copyright owner. That means you can stop someone from using it. You can make the, I worked at Paramount, we've got injunctions that forced us to pull back every single version of the movie, edit them to take out the stuff that we had taken from somebody without permission. We had to do that, the court told us to do it, and we did it, and it cost millions and millions of dollars to do that. Seizure, yeah, that's a nice one. They just sort of like take it, you never get it back. Damages and profits, which means you just don't get what the person was damaged by what you did. In other words, I didn't sell a whole bunch of these because you put these out in the marketplace, but you also get their profits, however much that the infringer made by doing it. And then if you can't prove your damages, the copyright law says, okay, fine, well, we'll give you at least $750, maybe up to $30,000, and maybe up to $150,000 for each work that you infringed. Right? So that's a pretty intensive thing. And then on top of that, we'll give the guy who's suing you all their attorney's fees. Now that one is really important, of course. But it's also going to end up being the most expensive ticket in the package in many, many cases when you're dealing with fan art. So when someone threatens you with the litigation based on copyright law, the biggest thing you should be concerned about is, wow, am I going to have to pay the attorney's fees of the person who sent me the letter, because you know it could be a law firm that charges $1,200 an hour, by the way, particularly for copyright lawyers. And then if you're really, really naughty, you can go to jail. So trademark. Trademark protects actual trademarks, like the Superman symbol. Trademark protects also the bottle design in the Coca-Cola bottle. The Coca-Cola bottle is trademarked, as is the name Coca-Cola. The style of lettering for Coca-Cola with the words Coca-Cola is also copyrighted. Harley-Davidson has a copyright in the sound of their motor when you turn it on. Which, you know, yeah, I just, you know, that's trademark. Trademarks, in order to become a trademark, it has to be affixed to goods in commerce, and the purpose of the affixation has to be to designate the source and origin of the goods. And to infringe a trademark, you have to do essentially the same thing. So there are a lot of people who will say, hey, you can't wear the Batman image, you know, you drew this morning with lipstick on your chest, because that's a trademark infringement. Well, unless you're trying to say that your chest comes from the Marvel, DC, and that you, in fact, your body was had as its source of origin DC Comics, and that you're available for sale, you know, you haven't violated the trademark, right? Learn something new every day. So it has to be a commercial use, or it can be a use that disparages the mark. So depending on what that person's chest looks like, DC could say, you know, what you're doing is you're diluting the value of my mark. You're making it less desirable. Arguably, you're enhancing it. That really just depends on what kind of chest we're talking about. And your use has to cause a likelihood of confusion as to the source and origin. So you have to say, you know, I'm just like, I'm confused. I don't know where this thing is coming from, right? Is this authorized or is it not authorized? If you're crossing that line where you've done your fan art so beautifully and you're using trademarks in it that it looks as if it was produced professionally and purposefully by the owner of that particular work, you've got yourself potentially a trademark issue. Injunctions, damages, not profits and damages, you have to pick. Seizures, and also criminal stuff. And then there's the right of publicity. which is also implicated in fan art. And the right of publicity is mostly state law. It covers the name, likeness, signature, and voice. So, you know, here what we're dealing with is Michelle Lee's personal rights. It gets very confusing in the area of fan art law, because she's sort of given her rights of publicity and personality to the company that produces Glee, has given them full rights to exploit her name, voice, and likeness with respect to Glee. And what you're taking as a fan artist is that aspect of her, not her personal aspects of herself. And so the result of that is it's very rare that you run into genuine, valid right of publicity claims in the area of fan art. And it only protects commercial exploitation. So if you're distributing your fan art like a true loving fan without accepting money for it, then you're in the clear in terms of right of publicity. And unfair competition, you know, which is the example here with Robert Downey Jr., where, you know, you produce, for instance, here a set of trading cards based on Iron Man. And you know, you're engaging in the aspect of building upon the marketing campaign that Marvel paid for in order to promote the Avengers and Iron Man. And that's considered unfair competition. And part of unfair competition is also actively misrepresenting, by way of example, that Marvel has endorsed your set of trading cards when they haven't. So, there are defenses to these mean, ugly laws, and most fan artists are familiar with them on some level. And there are defenses and exceptions. The best defense of all is implied consent. When Scarlett Johansson goes up on stage or at a step and repeat for the Avengers and says, wow, you know, I've looked at all this fan art on the internet of Black Widow and all this fan art of me, and I just think it's the coolest thing in the world. I love it, and I want my fans to continue doing it. That's implied consent. And so, you know, assuming that you're acting within the context of being a fan artist and you're doing images of Scarlett Johansson as Black Widow, you pretty much can rely upon that statement. It's a really good, you know, defense, because if someone overtly gives you permission or impliedly gives you permission to do that which they have the right to give you permission to do, then you've got permission to do it. When your parents said, yeah, okay, you can go do that, you know exactly what that meant. And so you go do something even more on top of it, probably. And that's where the issue comes with this defense, is nobody really knows how far it goes and how much permission was being given. Not being a commercial use in the area of trademark and unfair competition is a really critical defense and an exception. If it's not a commercial use, you're in the clear, as long as you're not besmirching the trademark in the case of trademark. And then there's this thing called fair use, which is the one that many of you have probably heard of. Fair use is a defense to copyright infringement. It's also a defense to trademark infringement. And there are these aspects to fair use that are quite complicated. I could do maybe 10 or 15 hours on it, which I've done when I teach law school. But they haven't given me that much time, so it's really sad for you. So if you just look at this, you'll get a sense of it. Fair use requires this really deep factual analysis of how much of the copyrighted work or trademark did you take when you made something else out of it, right? Was your use of it commercial or non-commercial? That's a big question, right? So if we go back to Darth Maul here, I can guarantee you this is a fair use if it's only on a canvas as an original work of art, okay? Why? Because the amount and taking is very much, I mean, it's like, that is Darth Maul, there's no question about it, right? I don't think it referenced an actual photograph of Darth Maul, so that's helpful, but sometimes that would also be the case. But assuming it's on a single canvas, right, the amount and extent of the commercial use of it depends on whether they're selling it commercially or just displaying it as fan art, right? And then the nature of the copyrighted work, well, Darth Maul is a film thing. And so the fact that you're transforming it into a canvas, right, actually gives you more protection under a fair use analysis, because that's considered to be transformative. And if it's transformative, that's considered to be encouraged by fair use, as long as your transformation of the work does not result in changing your analysis with respect to any of these other factors and throwing the balance off in the direction of the copyright owner. And then there's the effect of the use on the potential market. You know, the people who own Darth Maul, the Lucasfilm owners, the owners of those Lucasfilm franchises, their market is not going to be deeply impacted by a single canvas of Darth Maul. I mean, it's just not going to happen. So the person who's seeking to defend themselves on the basis of fair use has the stronger argument with respect to that factor. So you lose on some, you win on others, you put them in this little box, and then unfortunately the only person who can tell you whether you did okay or not is the Supreme Court of the United States of America. And every time this goes to the Supreme Court of the United States of America, all the copyright lawyers pretty much know which way it'll go, and it goes the exact opposite way when the decision comes out. Right? So fair use is great. It covers situations where you're using content for criticism, comment, news, teaching, scholarship, research, sometimes in other settings. But it's so complex and difficult to know whether you've crossed the line or not that it's really, really hard to raise it up as a defense when someone's written you a letter and they said they're about to sue you for 150 grand. It's just really, really hard to use. And I would say copyright owners are happy about that. Okay, you've got this exception. You may never know if you really met it or not. So, what is another defense? So the final defense is something in the United States that we call the First Amendment to the Constitution of the United States. Every state has its equivalent, and many, many other countries have the equivalent. And the notion of the First Amendment is that we protect speech. And, you know, at some point you begin to, as you mull this stuff around, you begin to realize that all this IP stuff has something to do with speech. And if it does, shouldn't the First Amendment and that idea of the First Amendment, of freedom of speech, come into play in terms of the analysis of whether you can use it or not and how you're using it? There's no question that you should have the right to make allusions to cultural ephemera. You should be able to sit and with somebody and talk about Star Wars. You should be able to sit with somebody and talk about Spock. You should be able to sit with someone and talk about being a bromie. These are things that you should be able to do in your life. They enrich your life. And there's no reason why you shouldn't, and these laws are not designed to stop you from doing that. And speech falls into all kinds of categories, particularly in the United States, where we've spent a lot of time suing people about it. You know, free speech is wearing fuck the draft on the back of your shirt. That went to the Supreme Court of the United States. Speech can involve just pure action, pure behavior, standing up and taking your clothes off and yelling at the world is a form of expression that is in fact protected by the First Amendment. There may be other laws that come in and that preclude you from doing that, but they can't stop you from doing it on the basis of expression. And copyright and trademark are protecting the expression of a work, and to the degree that those laws interfere with your right of free speech, you should be able to exercise it. And the Supreme Court has ruled that, in fact, the First Amendment is relevant to copyright protection, but they haven't told us how. They've avoided it every time it's been presented to them. But everyone agrees that copyright is supposed to protect a specific set of expressions, not the right to talk about the work in any way that you want to. So this is what I leave you with in terms of fan art. Okay? What is fan art? Fan art is a statement of saying, I love you. If we're going to protect people in their speech from saying the President of the United States should be impeached, to say that I think we should overthrow the government in Libya and protect people who say that, If that's going to be our standard, we should protect people who are simply saying, I love you, Wonder Girl, Batgirl. And I want to draw a picture that says that I love you. I don't want to sell it. I don't want to make $1 million off of it. I'm not saying that now I own Batgirl. All I'm saying is, I love you. And that should be protected. So, we have with us in the audience a fan artist. His name is Harold Smith. He's a composite of about 30 different fan artists. I'm going to ask him to come up and join us. Harold.
Have a seat. Nope. Okay.
Harold needs to disguise himself because he's deeply concerned about the liability resulting from his activities. So let me tell you a few things about Harold. When Harold was...
Excuse me?
Oh, I'll be careful, yes. You have to talk slowly, Harold, so we can alter your voice and still understand it. Okay. When he was 6 years old, he traced comic books. Copyright infringement. He remembers tracing cover art from his dad's Conan books, which sort of elevates him up a little bit in the world of art. When he was 10 years old, he was writing Star Wars stories with his pets as protagonists. He likes Boba Fett and Chewie. He still has a thing for Chewie. When he was 12 years old, he started taking art classes in middle school, and the teachers tried to stop kids from doing fan art completely. They had some bullshit story about how Disney shut down a school library for painting Mickey Mouse on the wall. They actually, by the way, had done that and did that. When he was 13 years old, he made Harry Potter graphic novels with his friends. We can tell that he had some daddy issues because he had Harry Potter kill Dumbledore. When he was 14, he was tagging businesses with Batman holding Super Mario mushrooms. That was a trademark infringement, copyright infringement, and probably a damage to both of those canons and franchises. At 16, he was like completely into crossovers of South Park, Simpsons, Beavis, and Butthead. He did Simpson as the X-Men and posted it to DeviantArt. It was extraordinarily popular, got millions of views. And so one day when he was around 17, he got a letter, and it was from 20th Century Fox. He thought it was because at Comic-Con he'd signed like so many lists and stuff that he was getting preview tickets to something. And instead it was a letter from Matt Groening, and Matt Groening's the creator of The Simpsons, and he invited him to come to Los Angeles. And when he came to Los Angeles, Matt Groening said, we want to turn your Simpsons as X-Men poster into, I mean, picture into a poster and sell it. And they got to talking, and he started working on The Simpsons full time. Never went to college, told his parents that he was now living in Los Angeles. That should happen to the rest of us in our dreams. He's freelanced for Marvel, DC, Electronic Arts, Titmouse, Dark Horse. He's done some sort of edgy, sort of quasi-pornographic stuff, which he's permitted. he's permitted me to tell you this because obviously he's anonymous and in disguise today. He also did, by the way, for some of you who are truly geek on sci-fi, he did all the backdrops for Serenity. I think, I don't know, have you ever been concerned as a fan artist that something would happen to you? Oh. Did you get that? He said not until his grandmother went to jail for illegally downloading music. Tell us a little bit about what it's like working on these big franchises that you've worked on. What do they think about fan art? So they like fan art?
They love it.
They love it. And do people do fan art in these shops?
That's what all of our downtime consists of.
I'm sorry, could you?
That's what all of our downtime consists of.
All of your downtime consists of fan art?
Yes.
Wow, that's pretty cool. I thought what we'd do now is, you know, the most interesting thing for you is likely going to be to ask questions. So I thought we'd move to questions. And if you have questions for me, that's fine. If you have questions for Harold, he'd be happy to answer them, and I'll be happy to translate. Yeah.
Is there some sort of database of copyright holders that are hostile to fan art?
So the question is there a database of copyright holders who are hostile to fan art?
And who are the most kind of hostile?
And who are the most hostile? No, there is no such database. And you know, hostility is in the eye of the receiver. And I really feel very uncomfortable saying who's the worst. Pretty much if you're implicating commercial rights and if you're engaged in an activity that has a strong commercial impact, and if you're dealing with a character that is controlled and published by a major corporation, you should think twice about it. They're quite active. They hire police forces, essentially private police forces, to go out and find infringing uses and try to knock them down. Yes?
As for commercial use, I've heard of some fan artists using their art and selling them to go towards charities, or also creating fan comics and then putting them out, only asking for the cost of materials. Would that be considered commercial?
So the question is if you have a distribution for charity of your fan art, if you only receive the cost of materials in return for the work, is that considered commercial or non-commercial? Highly likely to be considered non-commercial. On the other hand, it is the actual sale for charity is a commercial activity. And the other interesting thing is that there are many charities out there who are very aggressive in policing their trademarks to make sure that people don't misuse them in connection with their charity. So you could really get someone angry by saying that you were selling them for a charity without the charity knowing that you're doing that on their behalf. And there are very few charities that are actually going to want to participate in directly endorsing fan art activity because they'll be concerned that their commercial activity will be an issue. Try one, yeah.
A lot of artists in the comic industry will do individual drawings of copyrighted characters and sell them here at conventions or on eBay.
Right.
The practice has been going on for quite a while.
Right.
If Marvel or DC decided to stop that, wouldn't it be difficult to kind of put the horse back in the barn?
Yeah, so, you know, there's the rule of life, as I said, and the rule of life has been, to permit those kinds of uses for a variety of reasons, not the least of which being that many of those artists like Harold, hey, Harold, have you ever sold characters that without permission? Yeah. And have you ever gotten in trouble with DC or Marvel or anyone else? And when did you get in trouble?
When it hit 100,000 sales.
When you what?
When I sold 100,000.
When you sold 100,000 of them?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So, you know, there's a famous interview with 50 Cent when 50 Cent was releasing an album, and it was pre-released. The album hadn't been released yet, and he's being interviewed by MTV, and they say, well, you know, how do you think this album's going to do? He says, I don't know how, about what you mean about how I think it's going to do. We've already sold 1 million copies. His record company, you know, what? Well, he sold them in the hood, you know? So, you know, and was that a bad thing? Well, actually, ultimately, that was a good thing because he preceded the audience. He sold it to people who couldn't afford it at retail rates at a much lower rate. Of course, he kept all the money and didn't share it with anyone. But that's what makes 50 50, right? So, you know, these rules change, you know. So, yeah, if Marvel and DC decided to go on a campaign, the copyright law will back them up. Fair use will be a very difficult argument if you're selling it directly. On the other hand, if it's a, you know, if the work is done as a crossover or something like that, there's something really transformative about it. You know, it's something that you couldn't otherwise get, or it's done in a style in which the character isn't typically drawn, fair use will probably protect the artist. As I said, it's always about the facts and the law. Yeah. Yeah, no, it's very, very helpful to say it's entirely an expression of dedication. And it's very helpful to be entirely non-commercial. And it's very helpful to say this is not the product of the original authors, and that it's not intended to emulate that. All of that is helpful to say. You are engaging in copyright infringement. So, you will need to be protected by fair use or the First Amendment. Those are your choices. All of those things that I just said are helpful. Of course, it has to be true. You can't just sort of make it up. Yeah.
What about fan vids and like Photoshop images? I see a lot of people do collages and stuff with fan art as well as hand painting. And like fan vids, like say Star Trek.
Sure. So, as I said, it's all about the facts against the law. And, you know, you really need to have someone look at it who knows how to do that. And there are, you know, on the other hand, you know, it's when you get caught that you're in trouble. You know, you are building up your trouble as you get there. There's no question about that. And being funny is pretty good. Being funny, you know, parody is something that has been well looked upon by the courts. I think it's unfortunate that love doesn't get as much attention as parody. It should. It really, it genuinely should. What do you think about that, Harold? Have you ever been funny?
I was just funny right here.
What?
I was just funny.
What? Try this one.
I am being funny.
Oh, you are being funny. It's just that we can't see you smile. Yeah, yeah, it's life. Way over there. Yeah, yeah.
Is an original piece of work copyright or trademarked upon creation, or does one have to go through that formal process before the laws would protect somebody?
So the cool thing about copyright since 1977 in the United States and since forever in places like France is that copyright becomes a right, is owned by the author as it is fixed, as whatever they're doing is fixed. It, you don't own it while it's just up in your brain, and you don't own it if you are just talking about it with somebody. But as soon as you fix it, write it down on a piece of paper, type an email, a tweet, 140 characters can be copyrighted. As soon as you do that, it is copyrighted to the author, whoever the author is at the time that they're doing that. Yeah, with the mask.
Character say that they own the copyrights to the style that you developed.
Right. So smart artists who are hired on that basis ask for a clause that will protect them in that regard. In the film industry, by way of example, the Writers Guild of America has a standard agreement for writers that offers some protection with respect to that issue. Not as much as you would want, but then again, companies had people like me negotiating on their behalf, so how good were the writers gonna get? Yeah, that was a joke. Harold?
Yes.
Do you look at the contracts before you go to work for Marvel or DC or any of these companies?
No, I have a team that looks over my contracts.
You never look at your contracts?
No, I have professionals do that.
No professionals look at their contracts. Right. So what do you rely on to enforce your rights?
Intuition.
More questions? All the way at the back there.
What about accepting money to produce fan art even though you don't intend to sell it?
I approve.
Harold approves. Yeah, so this is very similar to an earlier question of, you know, if the only thing you try to recover is your cost of materials, right? So, you know, that's a helpful thing, right? But it's all going to turn on facts, right? And you always have to keep in mind that the copyright owner does have these basic rights, and they are very powerful, and they subsist whether it's for profit or not for profit, right? So, you know, you're going to have to argue the excuse. You're not going to have a leg to stand on in saying that the other side can't complain about it. Right there, yeah. Trying to hit pockets. Yeah, go ahead.
What do you think of the growing global political pirate party movement and their platform of IP reform? And do you think they're going to get any traction in the courts?
Well, they already have. They've been very influential on the SOPA and PIPA issues, which had to do with remedies involving shutting down website addresses that were engaged in mass copyright trademark infringement. Trademark and copyright infringement, by the way, also implicates industries like the pharmaceutical industry and others. So there's some very, very powerful commercial interests that need protection. I mean, they genuinely need the protection because the internet is this wide open environment. And some of it is potentially anonymous in the way it operates. So, you know, I don't know where the line gets drawn. I can tell you that I'm grateful for organizations like Public Knowledge, the Electronic Frontier Foundation, and the Pirate Party in Germany, which has been very active, because they are counterbalancing the political force that industries and commercial companies are able to produce, right? So you need balance in these discussions. It's about finding an appropriate balance. And you're not going to find that balance if there's nobody out there representing the interests of people who want to use copyrighted works and trademarked works in various ways. Yeah, all the way at the end there. Sites like what? I'm sorry.
Threadless.
Threadless is the t-shirt site. Oh, okay. Threadless. I'm sorry. Sites like Threadless. And what about them?
How does that work? Does Threadless get the rights from?
I know. You know. I haven't read their terms of use this week, but it would probably take me a week to read them. Threadless, those organizations really should not gain any interest in your work. If it's your work, you're putting it up there to be on t-shirts that other people order. You should be retaining the rights to that work. Certainly that's the case on DeviantArt. If you put works into our print program or if you offer them for sale on our site, through one of our download options. We have a brand new one that lets you make money off of downloads. You retain all rights to your work. You can pull it off the site whenever you want to. That's called respecting artist rights, which we try to do. Over there. Yeah. Well, it's going to be fact specific, but you have the rights to begin with. You can't get rid of them anymore. You can't get rid of them except by act of transfer. So unless, you know, you're going to, if you keep asking and changing it, then we're going to, then the answer is going to keep changing. So, you know, you can, you, it depends on how thinly you shave the onion. So if you just make it available for download and you don't tell people they're getting any rights in it at all, then you're essentially, by implication, saying you can have the copy that you download and none others. But you've also not done something very smart in terms of protecting your interests. Okay? Yes?
5 minutes. What about turning derivative works into original works?
The question is, what about turning derivative works into original works with quotation marks around original? Harold?
50 Shades of Grey.
Yeah. I've been waiting for the 50 Shades of Grey question. Did you like the book? No, she didn't like the book. What did you think of the other two?
Actually, I didn't read them. I was part of it, involved in the
FINMO.
Ah, okay, the
FINMO.
The proper answer. So 50 Shades of Grey is a really wonderful example of a situation where this is a book that started as a Twilight fanfic. From what I understand, not deeply incorporating the canon of the original work, just character names by and large. And then it really took off on the internet, millions of downloads. A publisher got involved and said, hey, we could make some money off of this. We're talking about piles of money have now been made. Paramount optioned it for a movie, blah, blah, blah. And what the author then did when that sort of commercial option presented itself was to just simply change the names to normal names as opposed to Twilight names, and some other changes as well, but not really high significant ones. That tells you how much of a derivative work the original was, if it turns out that the then rebooted version of it has been able to sail through, which it has so far, in terms of copyright objections. So, you know, it wasn't a very, you know, deeply derivative piece, right? On the other hand, the copyright law does have a section in it that if you make a derivative work, you, and it turns out it was an unauthorized derivative work, you lose your rights in all of the content that was not derivative that was contained in that work. So it can be a pretty severe penalty. Okay, well, so I guess that's it, right? So thank you very much. Really had a good time. Harold, thank you.
Thank you very much. Are you available to speak anywhere?
Sure.
Outside?
No, outside. I can
okay.
Outside.
If anyone would like to ask any more questions, he'll be available outside. Please exit that way.
I know.
A lot of this is where we're coming from.